It is 9:30. I've been up a few minutes. It's late. This is what I... Well, I mean, if I'm dealing with interference, this is the way it's gonna have to be. Wake up late at night, go right into the other room, and deal with it, and sleep in the afternoon, basically. Maybe eat my meal around breakfast. Maybe that's a good way to kind of guess when the peak usage is, right? I mean, my ears will tell me, right? This is the perhaps annoying truth. I caught a little roach in my bathroom, so did a spray. I got a fan running, and then the door closed. That's going to be a bit of a problem regarding the interference. I've been over this a few times, but I think that they're essentially coming in behind the bathroom. So the way I deal with this is I do a full spray outside the unit, you know, like behind the wall there. There's like a little space with an electrical box, and then I walk around. There's a staircase up there. There's like a back room with like a laundry facility and a kind of an open sewer back there. I mean, that's where they're coming from, right? But for some reason, they tend to want to come around back through here. They may be coming underneath, even, I don't know. I think that if we could figure out exactly where they were coming from, we can get rid of them entirely. But I've got like steel wool in the back there, and different, you know, there's all kinds of different approaches, right? To try to just kind of essentially block them off. But for right now, I don't. I mean, this the insecticide that I'm using is mostly harmless to humans. But nonetheless, I don't want to smell it all night kind of thing, right? So I'll have the fan run for a bit anyways. This is the right time of year. My understanding is that, because like I don't see them all year, right? I only see them a few times a year. It's usually around the same time of year. I think that I can even kind of time the weather, right? You want a folk weather trick. It's when the roaches start coming in, that's when it's fall, right? Or that's, let me rephrase that, that's when it's starting to turn to the cold part of fall, right? If you don't believe in fall, you don't believe in spring, you know, you just believe in winter and summer, then I guess that's when winter starts, right? That's when the cold part of fall asserts itself, that's when it starts snowing. The roaches seem to be able to guess it, in a permanent sense kind of thing, right? Because you'll get cold snaps, and that's the thing, is that if it's just a cold day, they won't come down, right? It's when the pattern shifts, that's when they start coming in, right? And that's what happened over the weekend, is the pattern shifted. So I guess that means you can probably expect an end to the warm weather for the rest of the year. That's when you start seeing them. Because like I said, I think that what's going on is that they kind of live outside. They might not live very far from here, right? But they live outside. This type of roach are the oriental roaches. They're the big ones. They can't climb. They just, you know. And that was a small one, which is a little bit different. I'm used to seeing big ones. Big ones in the fall and small ones in the spring. So that's actually a little bit concerning, the fact that I saw a smaller one today. Although maybe it's just it's a reflect. Maybe they had an extra long life cycle this year because of the extra heat. I don't know. But my understanding is basically they actually prefer to live outside. They're the kind of bugs that wants to live in soil, in leaves, in grass. They don't really want to come inside because they like heat and they like humidity, right? They come inside in the winter, and the main reason they come inside is to breed, right? It's a life cycle thing, right? And humans have been living with roaches for so long that maybe it's even, you know, they know to come inside where there are humans or where there's shelter in order to breed. That seems to be how it is, right? So they come in when it starts to get cold. and then they breed, and then they die, basically, right? So you can get them before they die. That's got to be the kind of trick, right? Is you want to get them before they lay eggs, because otherwise, you're killing little baby roaches for the next 4 or 5 months. Not really a way to stop them from coming in, short of, you know, redoing the foundation in the basement, right? I guess that's a reason to buy a new house, is that it's built in such a way that it keeps them out, until they find a way to get through, anyways. Until it falls apart. So, for the first 5 years or something, anyways. You know, and I've been over this before, too. Like, this is a neighborhood problem, right? If we really wanted to get rid of the roaches, we would have to have, like, a city program. And it's kind of one of the more annoying consequences of the property rights regime and the idea of owning individual property, is that because we're so obsessed with this is my land, this is my house, this is my property, we lack the basic social infrastructure to deal with pest infestations, right? And so, you know, person on lot A gets all the roaches off his lot and then blames it on the person on lot B for not doing, you know, not holding up to your responsibility. Well, if you just work together instead of focusing, you know, on this sort of atomized concept of this is mine, I control me, right? If you work together and you've created a community anti-infestation program, then you could actually get some work done. So why don't I do that? Because nobody listens, right? Although, I mean, if it ever got to the point, I would have to do it, because I would know that it's the only serious solution, right? Is to start knocking on doors. Okay, let's go to the community center, let's have a talk, and let's have a strategy where we all work together, right? That's how you deal with a bug infestation. That's how you deal with a rodent infestation, right? And the property rights concept, the idea of, like, this is my land and I control me, is such an obstacle in building these kinds of communitarian approaches towards what are community problems. When you have a community issue, you need a community to solve it, right? But yeah, see, there's one right there. Where's it going? Is it going in there? No. I thought that one looks like... No, that's an oriental roach for sure. Okay. It's just the time of year. This is when they come in. And they're not really anything to do about it, except take them out. Like I say, you gotta hope that you get them before they breed. Because that's why they're here. They're here to lay eggs. They think this is a safe place to lay eggs, because they've laid eggs in human dwellings for however many thousands of years. And if you don't catch them before they lay their eggs, then you gotta deal with killing their eggs for the next 6 months. Or just the little ones. I haven't seen any centipedes around. That's the other sign that you know that you're in roach season, is when you see centipedes. I haven't seen any centipedes in a few months. The centipedes are good because the centipedes will eat the roaches. They will eat the roach sacks. Even better, but that one looks like it was damaged. It had already come into contact with a little something sprayed, and it was trying to get away, kind of finding somewhere to die. So I will probably actually see a few more come out over the next little bit as that asserts itself. Nothing to do. It's up to it. So. There are, I mean, I could, I need to go dust off the building code, right, and give it to the you know, property. But I mean, that's the problem, right? Is that we have a legal system. Our legal system forces the property owner to deal with the problem. It's the neighborhood, right? I don't want to dust off the city bylaw and give it to the property owner, or the province bylaw and give it to the, it's not a bylaw, it's a provincial law and give it to the property owner. I want to go to the municipality and get the municipality to admit, to accept that this is the municipality's issue. It's not the property owner's issue, it's the city's issue. And if I want to deal with it, I want the city to deal with it, not my landlord to deal with it. Anyways, my battery's just about to go, so I'm gonna give listening a try. The fan in there might be a problem. If it works, great. If it doesn't, I'm gonna get a smoothie and wait it out a little bit. Definite interference. I guess it's still early enough that I can hope that it gets a little better after I get something to eat. So, get something to eat and then try again. Okay, so the interference looks like it's here to stay. It's a little after midnight, 4 minutes past the hour here on J-Babble. It's a little after midnight, and the interference is here to stay. So I'm going to have to... It's manageable just by kind of closing the circuit with my fingers. I probably should have never taken the aluminum foil off. It's just I noticed that it was like... Okay, so let's back up. I had a small amount of aluminum foil just on the ears, and it was successful for a while. And then I noticed in the spring or something, it was no longer... No, it would have been... No, it was the summer, yeah. I noticed it was no longer successful, so I tried to, you know, create an entire Faraday cage over the wire, and that was just... It's a crazy idea. Although, you know, if I could create one... There's little devices that you can use. They're like little filters, but I don't really want to do that because I'm mixing through a pair of headphones. I may end up cracking and just experimenting to see, but I would expect that it would have a degradation in sound quality, so I don't want to do that. The full Faraday cage over the wire was crazy. I mean, I tried it, and it was like you couldn't move the wire. If you tried to move the wire, the cage would break. It was like I say, if they could make it so that it's like flexible, like a long flexible thing, you have to make it out of a different material than foil, obviously, but... In fact, I kind of found it was worse, and you might expect that, actually, because if there's holes, all you're doing is you're trapping it, right? What I'm noticing today is that I'm picking up charge fairly quickly, but I'm draining it just as fast, right? So something I tried was, I thought, well, maybe I can just try grounding me, right? Because I had my feet up here like this and everything else, right? So I thought, okay, well, maybe if I put my feet on these... these porcelain, what do you call those things? Baseboards. Maybe that might help. And it didn't. What did help was if I just put my fingers over like that on both sides, right? But obviously I can't sit there like that. So that's ultimately what the foil did previously. It might be, like, season-specific. Like, I might have to change this, like, depending on what the weather is, because it might have something to do with the furnace or the other things. I've got the door closed, because I remember last year that I had the door closed. If I'd had the door closed, and then I opened the door because I had the nasty migraine. I thought the air quality in here was bad. So I'll have to keep an eye on that, too. One thing after another. Okay, so... Let's try to get the foil back on here. Yeah, I'm going to turn this off and cut the circuit first. But let's see if we can get... I'm thinking that all I really need to do right now is shield this area here, right? Because like I said, I was using this to ground, but I mean, if you think about it for a second, like, all I'm really doing is grounding to myself, right? It's myself that's grounding and not the metal connector there. It might help a little bit, but I'm ultimately draining it into myself, so. Yeah, let's just get the wire on there and try it. Okay, so as before, let me focus on that. Okay. As before, I think the actual benefit of this is you see how it comes up a little bit? Actually, you might not see that. Just a second. I think the actual benefit is to cover this area here. That seems to be where it's kind of getting in there. Something else that might be a good idea is to try electrical tape. All I have is masking tape right now, so I might want to pick some electrical tape up too. This is basically what they do when they shield a wire, right? This is what a shielded wire is. They might not use technically aluminum, or if they do, they may use a different grade of it. But that's what they do, is essentially they take the wire and they wrap it in aluminum foil. And then they put the plastic around it, right? So it's essentially what I'm doing is I'm shielding it at the tip here. If I get a little bit of electrical wire electrical tape, that's what electrical tape does, right? Is it shields, so. I just didn't want to put tape on there for obvious reasons, right? But if I can put the tape over top of the aluminum, I can maybe minimize its effects. So. This is a hack. I wanted to find the source. I'm trying to find the source for over a year now. So, I think it's clear enough that whatever the source is, and I said this like last year, is that whatever the source of the noise is, like I can't do anything about it, right? Like let's say I'm able to figure out that the source of the noise is the Windsor hum, the mysterious, the infamous Windsor hum. It's actually not so mysterious, though it may perhaps be infamous. It's almost certainly industrial work going on Zug Island. And the actual thing that we're dealing with over here in Windsor is the fact that the entire city is built on top of a salt mine. And essentially what's happening is that over on Zug Island they're drilling, and we're just getting all the echoes because the ground that we're on is hollow. We're on hollow ground. So, I mean, you can either tell them to stop drilling over on Zug Island, which is like, yeah, right? Or probably a better idea is to fill the mines. I think some of them are actually still in operation. But a lot of them, it's just like there were salt mines that were 100 years ago, and it's just still sitting there. Maybe we'll go down, if I could figure out a way down there, maybe we'll go down there one day and just hang out in the salt mines. I don't know. That would be intriguing, wouldn't it? I gotta finish my discography before we talk about doing anything else here. So let's, yeah. Hopefully that works. I expect it to at least be better. I might have to drink extremely high peak. Like I might not be able to mix on Friday nights, right? I think I already figured that out. But like I should, it's Monday night. I should be able to mix tonight. It's mild. It's just it's persistent, right? So hopefully that fixes it. Sorry, I lost my train of thought there. That was That was an epic, epic loss of focus there. What I was saying was, like, let's say I determine that it's the winds or hum that's causing my interference problem. What am I going to do about it? Let's say I determine that it's a power station, it's a radio station. Like, there's nothing... I think that understanding that it's environmental is just about as much as I can get out of this, right? There's really nothing else that I can do or nothing else that I can accomplish besides that understanding that I'm in a noisy area. Maybe I'll just, the next time I move somewhere, I'll do testing before I move in. Just hang out in the lobby with a pair of headphones on for an hour. I don't plan on moving for a long time, unless I absolutely have to. Although this is, if you could list, I can go through 10,000 reasons why somebody would move, and they'd be like, no. The one reason that I would want to move is if I happen to be in a magnetic field that's destructive to me. A magnetic field is the one circumstance, and like, what's the chances, right? Who would even think of that? I moved a long way to come here. And I apparently should have tested the area for magnets. This is my life. It's just one ridiculous challenge after another. And the challenges of this sort that you don't expect normal people to have to deal with, right? Who would have thought? I move 800 kilometers so that I can get some mixing done in a place that's cheap. And I'm stuck in a magnetic field and I can't use headphones. Who would have thought that? Who would have ever thought that? But it's just one, there's a pattern in my life. And this is the type of thing that I deal with over and over and over again. Or maybe I'm just cursed with sensitive ears, right? Perhaps most people wouldn't have even noticed. Perhaps I'm... You know what? Let's embrace this. Music for cyborgs. I'm composing for cyborgs 300 years in the future. I'd rather embrace that than ridicule it. So that didn't help. At all. In fact, it may have actually made it worse. This is different than before. I turned something off, I guess. The issue before, I always got static in the phones. I'm not getting any static in the phones this time. Which means like my marker, the thing that I was using to let me know that there's something wrong, is not working. I'm going to, I switch back to the old, brace. I've tried a few different combinations with the foil. It's just, I cannot get the highs to stay, the highs fade. And even more so on this record, the highs are very important because there's so much noise. And all the noise, all the details at the top. So, like, I'm not interested in making records to dance to, right? These are... The intended audience, is for people to listen to it, through headphones. What does that mean? Well, it could be on the bus. It could be when you're exercising. But it's headphone music. Or it could be just, enjoy it by yourself in a bed with a good pair of headphones on. You know, that's to me, those are my favorite records, are the ones that you just put a pair of headphones on and just lie in bed and just listen to it. I'm not much of an advocate for music as a social activity, right? For me, music is about escaping. Music is a very highly personal, you know, introverted thing that listening to music is something that you do by yourself. Probably why I've always put so much more of a focus on recording music than performing it, right? Because I'm not interested in, you know, doing a putting together a show or touring or putting on a concert. Like, these aren't really things that have ever. I mean, there's a time, I guess, when I was very young where, you know, I mean, it becomes attached to it, right? You make music. I guess it's kind of the same thing as the lyrics in the song, right? Songs have lyrics. It's just what songs are, right? And it took me a while to grow past that point, right? The first song on this record that I'm trying to mix is kind of that point where I said that, okay, I don't have to have lyrics in songs, right? I can write songs and not have lyrics in them. And that, I mean, it didn't really hit me totally at that point exactly, but moving on, a lot of the songs I wrote after this didn't have lyrics. And nowadays, when I write a song, it almost never has lyrics. Kind of like that, right? I mean, you start off playing music and you think that you need to perform it, right? And what I found moving on as I grew is I got to a point, I don't know, sometime maybe in the. It wasn't much further than this, it was like 98, 99-ish that I had no interest in performing music, right? My interest in music was purely in recording it and making recorded music, making records, making music for people to listen to through headphones, okay? Not music that people will go to a concert to see, not people, certainly not music for people to dance to. You know, not music that people will share with each other. Well, maybe a little bit music that people will share with each other, but music that people will share with each other over the internet would be preferable. Right? Not music that people will sing to, not music for the radio, not music for political ends, music solely for somebody to listen to by themselves as a purely personal, you know, individualistic, introverted activity. You know, and I'll make the argument that that's like that's really what music is, right? To really truly understand music, you have to experience it alone. If you only get anything from music, like with people, then you don't really like music. You like people. And this is just like an excuse for a social, you know? Like, it's a means to an end. What you really want is a social gathering. What you really want are, you know, to find people that think like you. You don't really like the music. I know that there's kind of a large academic understanding of music as something social, right? It's like some anthropological concept of music as a, you know, as a mating ritual, or music as a, as, you know, as a tribal connection mechanism, or, you know, etc. You know, and that's. I don't want to say that's untrue, right? But, like, I've never lived in a tribal society. I don't know what living in a tribal society is like. I don't want to live in a tribal society, and I don't want to know what living in a tribal society is like. You know, I don't. I think there's a lot of things we can do to make our society better, but it's largely around maximizing the ability to do things like listen to music by yourself, right? Music should be organized to allow people to listen to more music by themselves. And if you want to call that escapism, I'll agree with you, but I won't look at, I'm not going to look down on escapism. I'm going to argue that there's nothing out there in the real world that's worth living. Escapism, yes, please. And let's organize society in a way that maximizes escapism. So, I mean, I wouldn't use the term escapism. I just use the term enjoyment, right? The maximizing individual pleasure is far more important than existing in some social community or something, right? I mean, when we have problems, we need to come together and deal with them together, right? But then we should be moving apart afterwards, right? The community is useful to solve problems, but it's not ideal as a way to enjoy ourselves. I'd rather hang out by myself. So that's what this music is for, right? It's. You know what? I forgot where I was going with this. But, I mean, this is headphone music to listen to alone. Whatever that means, like I say, on the bus, the gym, in your bed, whatever. So it's important that I get the high end. And it's just not staying. So this is coming. What I wanted to point out was that it's not working. Like I say, I don't know how I got on that tangent. I don't remember, and I don't. I we're not gonna go back. What we're gonna do is. One of the reason I moved this desk from over here to over here was because I thought maybe I might have better luck with that power out. So I've done just about everything I possibly can, or any sort of thing I can possibly think of, and it's the interference remains oppressive. So I've got everything off. I'm gonna swap outlets. And we'll see if it makes a difference. Yeah, so what I did was I unplugged the power bar from that outlet and plugged it into that one. It didn't make any difference. And really, there's not a lot of reason I think I should have thought it would have. It's on the same circuit, right? What difference does it make if I plug it into there or plug it into there? It doesn't make any difference at all. So the next step is, to check for power to see if I can find a way to remove the power interference would be to, check all those different outlets and do it one by one, all the different combinations and all those kinds of things. I'm gonna do something else. And I'm gonna do this something else because I think it'll help me understand kind of a broader power regulation concern. When the power went out in August, we learned that there is an outlet over there that is not on the main grid for this room. So this room has a circuit, and essentially everything and this room is on the circuit, including the fridge, except the stove and that one outlet. So, if it happens to be that the power in here is wired screwy or whatever else. There still remains the possibility that that outlet is good. Now, as we saw before, that other outlet is right in the kitchen. I moved my fridge over and plugged it in, and I had my laptop on the floor. We'll think back to that. Remember that it wasn't a very pleasant setup. But for testing purposes, if I can figure out at least that that works, or that the interference is free from there, or it's less, or whatever, then I can take that to the landlord, who is actually an electrician, and explain that to him, and maybe he can. I'm trying to think, when did this problem start? This problem started in the summer of 2015. I started noticing some funny shit a little bit before that, but it was summer 2015 that it really got bad. And there were some power outages. He'd just come down and be like, I'm turning the power off for 20 minutes because I've got to do some work in the back. I think that it's entirely plausible that what I'm dealing with is ultimately reducible to that. Now, I have contacted him. I asked him if I could borrow a Gauss meter, and he doesn't have a Gauss meter, even though he's an electrician. I guess Gauss meters are more for physicists than electricians. I mean, I don't think this guy has like a PhD in electricity or something. I may know more about electricity than him, but he knows about circuits and how to wire them and to do it safely and all that kind of stuff, right? That's, being an electrician is not the same thing as being a physicist. I know that. I may have forgotten that when I asked him for a Gauss meter, but nonetheless, I don't know how to wire a box like that back there. I'm clueless about that kind of stuff, right? So, if I moved this over into the kitchen for a couple of days. I mean, I'll know pretty quick if it works or not, right? But if I can move it over there, and if it does work, and it stays stable for a while, then I may not have found the source of the problem, but I can at the very least say, listen, you know, you've got a converter plugged in backwards, or I mean, what would create a field? It's something that's what would create a field, right? Is if you've got something plugged in backwards, or something unregulated, maybe. This place is all inclusive. I don't pay an electrical bill. And he's not really particularly concerned about how much money I'm spending on electricity. It's kind of curious to me. That's the nice thing about being an electrician is that you can set up a dirty hookup, right? Is that what's going on here? Do I have a dirty hookup and it's the inverter's fucked and I'm getting a field? And I don't know. Is there a ground issue back there somewhere? Right. I think at the very least, if I can try a different circuit, I can figure that out. So, I mean, I need to be clear. I do still think the problem's in the air, but like, it's not just the air. It's the air is interacting with something. So, Let's see if we can try that. What I'm describing, what I'm describing it's an understood common issue that unshielded headphone cables pick up sound from bad wiring. That's understood. It's a problem that a million people have had, and a million people have solved through those, I can't remember what they're called, but they're like little, they're resistors basically, and you put them on the top of your headphone. Like I said, I don't want that because I'm concerned that would modify the sound. I may end up cracking and trying it, but so I mean, this is not a, I'm not the first person in the world that's had problems with unshielded cables, right? It's just like it was fine for a long time, or at least I thought it was fine for a long time. It could be that I just never noticed it, but it's I think it'll be useful just to try it anyways. If nothing comes of it, then what did we do last time? What we did last time was we waited. We waited until the signal came down. When did I do the mixing? I did the mixing over Christmas. Buddy upstairs may have been gone. I don't want to start thinking about saving up to move out. The reason is that I was supposed to be here until I finished my discography. And then once I finish discography, I'll decide, you know, what has inflation done to rent? What has inflation done to my disability? Is it still important to me that I live in a city? Or am I a little older now, and am I okay about moving to a small town? Because I can get even cheaper rent if I move to Sudbury. But then you've got to live in Sudbury. No, I mean, I'm going to get to a point. I mean, I'm in my mid-30s now. I'm going to get to a point where I'm not going to want to go to see concerts all the time anymore, because everybody there is 20, 25 years younger than me, and I feel out of place. I'm not there yet. But, you know, it's maybe not that far away. The plan was to finish the discography. And then, once the discography's done, I'm going to focus mostly on my website. And that's, at that point, like, website and listening to music. Doing, like, music reviews and stuff, right? And I've been kind of worried that I'll sell my gear and then I'll want it the day after I sell it, right? That's how it always works. When I do switch over to focusing full time on the website, am I really going to be done all music forever? Strikes me as hard to believe. Even if that's what I'm planning around. If my hearing goes, then I suppose that decision will be made for me, right? Which is why what I'm dealing with right now is the extra bit annoying. Because I don't have forever to do this. And the more time I have to waste dealing with signals in the air, the more time is sneaking away on me. I can waste a day. I can waste a week. I've wasted a year. Anyways, let's not get too far ahead of ourselves. Let's just go into the other room and see if we can see what this sounds like through the other circuit and go from there. So, is it worth... I couldn't get the desk through the thing, so is it worth picking it up on its side and pulling it out just to test it? I'm going to say no. If... I listen to this at what? 3:30? If I get a better outcome out of here, I'll think about it. But for now, this is just to test it. I don't have high expectations. We'll find out. I think if anything, the fact that the fridge is here is probably a big problem. But, we'll find out, huh? It's up! Let's get Cubase running and listen. I have not finished my first run yet, but I do have to pee. So, let's have a talk here before I do that. The first couple of songs, was not picking up really anything. I picked up a small amount. Initially, but and we don't know, you know, if it's gonna build. I did something to break my control. I swapped my headphone cans. Here's the thing with that: they both say left channel on them. Which is which? But both of the headphones say left on it. So I could fly around in circles with them. If I'm concerned that maybe the inverter's backwards, maybe I've got my magnets backwards. But should that make a difference? I don't think so, but it at least gives me a little bit of hope, right? And a reason to switch back. I'm going to keep listening to this. I'm going to sit in here probably for, like I say, it's about 3:30. Well, it was about 3:30. It's about 4 now, right? You know, it's 4 now. 10 to 4. I'm going to sit in here, and if I don't pick anything up after, 3 or 4 hours, I'm going to be left to conclude that there might be something better in here. But I'm going to test it, right? I'll go back into the other room, and if I immediately pick up interference, and then come back here, and then it's fine again, Actually, you know what? Fuck it. If it sounds good in here, let's finish the record in here. No, like seriously. Or at least finish the up to track 12, because I wanted up to track 12 to be done like 3 or 4 days ago, right? So if I can sit in here and it's stable and there's no interference, then let's get what I've got in front of me done. And go from there. Okay, so I did pick some up in here too. That might seem disappointing, but it's actually relieving, because that means that this isn't an answer. So I don't want this to be an answer. I could hardly move the stuff in here. I was thinking maybe I might move it in here, and then do kind of a swap, right? Maybe move the studio in here, and move the living room over there. Not as outlandish as it might sound. Damn, it's cold in here. Okay. But that's not gonna happen. Let's just get this back in there. I mean, it seemed like it was a little bit less, but how many times have I been through this? Sounds like it's kind of, no. I live in a magnet. I've got to accept that, and I don't know what's next. I don't hear any discernible difference. I have split. I now have the mixer over on that side of the desk because I put the monitor and computer in one outlet and the mixer in the other. It probably shouldn't make any difference because they're basically on the same circuit, but so I'm actually kind of more concerned about, like, because if I do it that way, then I can avoid crossings. And if I'm generating a field, or if I'm having a field interference issues, obviously the field is out here somewhere, but something that might generate a field that might interfere with the one that's out here is if I've got crossings in the back. The mixer is a bit of a beast. It's a possibility. That might be why it sounded a little bit better off the bat in there, just because there was less crossings. I'm gonna get my blanket and go back and listen and see. Let's see how long it stays okay for. No, it's no good, same problem. What am I gonna do? I'm gonna get a bagel. It works sometimes. I really don't think I have any, like, what else can I do? Okay, none of these power things make any difference either, so I'm just gonna shut this right down, and I'll put that back there where it was before. It was actually better when I had the static, because at least I knew, you know? The way it is now, like, I can't even tell when it's bad and when it isn't. I just have to unplug it and plug it back in. And my ear can tell me, but I'm not getting the same, you know? It's almost like I've got, like, a total decrease in output or something. I don't really, like, there's not really anything I can do besides keep trying. Right? I guess what I can do in the short run is I can, at least build inri019. There's not really going to be anything I can do, once that's done, besides sit and listen. Until it sounds right. Right? Let's do it over and over again until it sounds right. That's what I had to do the last time. I just sat and I listened over and over again. I got an opportunity here and there. That's really all I can do. I live in a magnet. And I don't have any way out. So. There's the brilliant logic of the Calvinist. Why don't you work really hard and then, yeah. So, instead of wasting my time hoping it works, I'll waste 10 times as much of my time trying to get to a situation and then have to waste 100 times more of my time trying to get back into the situation that I'm in now. Now, This is the lesser of evils, is to sit and hope it works. Try to find patterns as to when it is, like what time of the day is better, what time of the week is better, and hope I can work it out. I have no plans to vlog until this gets done. I have no plans to go online at all until this gets done, so. Could be a long, frustrating couple of weeks, but we'll find out. So I finished my bagel there. And I got the TV off. It's going to be off for a while. Computer will be off for a while. It's just, it's not even just about reducing interference now. Now it's about, like, ensuring that I stay focused, because I don't want to, like, I've been through this so many times where it's just, like, I lose focus and, you know, I can't get it to sound right, so I just get frustrated and I spin out, but I'm not going to do that this time. I'm going to sit in front of the computer until it's functioning and until it works, and that's all there is to it. But I was having a bagel and I was thinking about something, so let's have a little talk here. Could Donald Trump get primaried? I know a lot of people were thinking about Hillary getting primaried. And it seems maybe the wrong question to ask, you know, a couple of days after he gets elected. Or elected, I think that he stole the election. I've been clear about that. Meaning, you know, the whole, could he get primaried? Primaried, right? Stole the elections, why not just steal your own primary, right? But, could it happen? People are talking about him, you know, being a one-term president, because he might not want to run a second term even. People are, I mean, one term? I mean, that might even be, he's old. He's the oldest president of all time. I mean, or the oldest elected president of all time. Reagan wasn't even that old. He's past retirement. He might not survive 4 years. Let's be clear about that. And he's not in good health either. So, like, he's an old guy in bad health. But could he be primaried? Well, there's something unique about Donald Trump. Of all the unique things about Donald Trump, apparently he won the primary this year, or last year, by, no, it was this year. He won the primary this year by bringing in people that normally are not registered as Republicans, which is kind of a funny trick. It's supposedly the same thing that won Obama the nomination. Funny how these presidents that kind of come out of nowhere and nobody thinks ought to be president, or nobody thinks are qualified to be president, people that really have no business running for president, they seem to bring in people, you know, all these new voters from nowhere. it's a repeatable pattern. It's kind of curious, isn't it? All these people that vote in the Republican primaries that weren't Republicans, where did they all come from? But nonetheless, if you hold to that logic, it may very well be the case that his base may not exist. So if you hold to that logic, it may be the case that his base may not exist 4 years. It may not exist 2 years from now. And so if some movement conservative comes out of nowhere, or doesn't even have to come out of nowhere, it could be Ted Cruz, or it could be whoever, whatever other, you know, banker's darling decides to run as a real conservative. Even 2 years from now, all of these people that voted for Donald Trump thinking he was going to bring jobs back, you know, like crazy thinking, right? Like he promised people things that there's a few things we can be wait and see on. You know, we can be wait and see on the foreign policy. We can be wait and see on the infrastructure spending. But the jobs, like manufacturing jobs in Wisconsin, manufacturing jobs in Michigan, that's not going to be brought back by any president ever. Those jobs are gone, right? Even if manufacturing comes back, it'll be automated. Like those, the promises he made that won him the election in Michigan, Pennsylvania, Wisconsin, supposedly, right? Like that's nonsense. That's never going to happen. You can forget that before it happens, right? So we don't even have to have a wait and see. There's going to be people that voted for him that are going to be upset
not just 4 years from now, but even 2 years from now. And so the question comes up, if someone like Ted Cruz did decide that he wanted to run a primary against him, would Donald Trump have enough support to fend him off? I think there's a pretty strong argument that he would not. I said a whole bunch of times that this election is not really so important. The really important one is in 2020, when the demographic shift, when all the old people start going, you know, and the young, you know, when, you know, 48 years from now, when old means Gen X, right? Or when senior means Gen X. And when that happens, a lot of things are going to shift, right? I may in the end be more right than I realized. We'll find out, but don't discount the possibility. Yeah, Donald Trump might get primaried. Don't be surprised if it happens. I mean, everything about him is unconventional, right? Don't be surprised if his end is unconventional too. That is if he lives long enough, right? Also, do not be surprised if he has a massive coronary heart attack within a few weeks of actually coming to terms with the nature of his responsibilities, right?
Something very weird going down here. This just froze twice. Try number 4 at 8 o'clock. Swap my batteries. I'm trying to... Remember one of those batteries gave me like a half an hour, which wasn't so bad. I'm going to try and work one of those back in, but I got the wrong one. So I'll try again, test it again. I think that the next time that comes up, it'll be good. And I mean, I won't use them every cycle, but I'll put them inside kind of as an emergency just in case, until I get some more. If I get some more, it might not be the first thing on my list. It's a little after 8 o'clock. I don't know if those tries went through or not. If they did, then I'm repeating myself, and I will repeat myself. I'm under stress. Yeah, if you get that one, you've got a good taste. I'm distressed. I'm distressed. I repeat myself when I'm distressed. I repeat. It's a little after 8, and I am a little bit distressed, because, it's getting better, though. I've got 5 and 6 done, put aside completely. I'm working on 7, it's probably not too long before 7's done. It was already done, and then 9, 10, 11 will come up together. I just need to get a cleaner signal on all 3 of them. 9 I might mess with a little bit. But 10 and 11 are pretty much there. And then 12 was already done anyways, right? So after that, it's... The only thing I got left to do is a single. Sorry, is a symphony. And the symphony is like... Okay, so it's what? It's 15, 16, 17, 18, 19 on the original disc. 16 and 18 are already mastered, right? Then 15, 16, and 19 really just need a gloss so that it's the same master all the way through. And then I just need to sequence it to make sure that I got, you know, that I can hear it. I think the only actual mixing I'm going to do is going to have to do with some, it's the sun. The sun. The sun. I think the only actual, jeez, that is crazy. See, it's supposed to be winter. Actually, you know what? I think it is. I haven't been outside in days. I think it actually is winter now. Don't quote me on that, but it might be actually cold today. That's, I've been telling you for weeks that we've been getting this bright sun, and it hasn't been cold. You know, we've been getting those nice, those high-pressure winter days where it's supposed to be cold, but it's been hot. I think that we actually have a high-pressure day where it's cold. That appears to be what's happening. We're getting, these are some of the shortest days of the year, remember, right? I'm at the end of November. It's the end of November already. Okay, yeah, but we're getting to the end of the year, right?
So I've got like the days start getting longer again in 30 days. Yeah. It's a month. It hasn't even gotten cold yet. This is, you know what? This is at least positive when you think about it that way, right? I've only got a month before the days get longer again. That's great. It is. That's amazing. I love that. It hasn't even been cold yet. But I don't think it's, I mean, the last couple of days, I think it's been cold. I haven't been outside, so it doesn't matter. So long as I'm able to stay inside when it's cold, then it's as though it was never cold, right? But so yeah, I mean, the symphony is going to be very easy to mix when I do it. It's just I got to do it, right? So I'm like, I don't need, the only actual part, mixing part is going to be mixing on some vocal relics that I probably should have done in the first place. I just kind of forgot, right? So, or I didn't realize. So this is, if the signal's clear, I should run through this like in a day or two, right? It's just what have I been doing for the last week? It hasn't been mixing. I haven't been mixing for the last week. I've been waiting for the signal to clear for the last week so that I can mix. The mixing won't take long as soon as I can get a clean signal, and it's better right now. It's not perfect, but it's a lot better. So hopefully that holds for. Well, I'm wasting time basically. I gotta take my pills. That's why I got up. I just wanted to give a little update here, but it looks like try number four. Fourth try is a charm. And let's get back to work now. Seems like my window of opportunity this morning was small, but I got something done. So I'm gonna go ahead and upload. I need to hop online quickly because I need to renew my prescription online. So. That's an opportunity to do some things on there. I won't be on there long, but I'll let the machine or let my mixer cool down a little bit, and I'll be back in a few hours. But I think that was my window of opportunity this morning. It was about, I guess it was about 6 to 9. That's all I got, 3 hours a day. That's brutal. So better than working. Okay, but I don't know. If I mean the interference is bad. Maybe it'll go away this afternoon, I don't know, but I can't tell. There's no use in sitting around and pretending it works when I know that it doesn't, so. I can do some shaping. I don't I do some work with the second symphony, but right now I'm gonna like I say, it's a prescription I gotta renew, so I might as well upload while I'm at it. But I mean, that's it looks like that's all I had is about 3 hours this morning. That's it. I actually still don't think that Trump is going to pull out of the TPP. I'm sorry. He may be setting up some kind of optical charade with Congress. What I actually think is that he fundamentally does not understand what the TPP actually is. I think he probably thinks that it's a trade deal with China. When his advisors sit him down and explain that it's a containment strategy of China, that is, that it is a completely consistent with the anti-Chinese strain in his foreign policy, I believe he'll prove Obama right and come around to it. I just can't comprehend how they're going to let him abandon East Asia to China after 70 years, and that is the truth of it. Pulling out of the TPP is handing over the entire region to China, including Japan and Australia. There's lots of reasons I don't like this agreement, okay? I don't like all the investor rights things, the ISDSs, and I think we should be focusing on lessening militarization. That doesn't mean I don't understand the way the military thinks, and I do. And if you have an aggressive strategy to try to go after this rising power, like if that's your logic, then this is logical. And that is Trump's logic. That's the state's logic. I can't get my head around the idea that he won't do it. So I do remain convinced that he's just totally clueless, and that the situation may be severe enough
that his life may depend on gluing in. If they're going to do it, they'll do it fast. It's one of those things that, like, I mean, I don't know what it means for him to say that he's going to... He can't just stop the agreement, right? He's not the dictator. But as far as the premise of it goes, like, if he ends up stopping this somehow, that's the kind of thing that, you know, they could take him out over that. I mean, the guy campaigns on getting tough on China and then hands over trillions of dollars of GDP to them on day one. You need to believe him on getting tougher on China. Okay, that's the one thing that he said that you should take seriously. It just needs to be explained to him that the TPP is all about getting tougher on China. And then he'll say, the TPP is a great agreement. We gotta get tough on China. Sign the TPP, get tough on China. I found this article here at Slate. And basically, yeah, what I'm saying is right. This is a quote from Donald Trump.
The TPP is a horrible deal. The deal is going to lead to nothing but trouble. It's a deal that was designed for China to come in as they always do, through the back door, and totally take advantage of everyone.
Completely wrong. Wrong. But he believes that somehow, still, right? The truth is the exact opposite. It's a containment policy. It's designed to make it harder for China to trade with the people around it. That's exactly what he wants. He should sign it. Somebody will eventually set him straight. It will get signed. Once he understands what it is. I mean, don't get me wrong here. I'm not a fan of the agreement. I'd like to see it stopped. But you don't hear Trump talking about the ISDS mechanisms. You don't see him talking about labor or environmental standards. He honestly thinks it's a trade deal with China. He just truly does not understand it. And he's going to have to eventually understand it, somehow. I don't know, you want to draw him pictures? He's going to have to get it. And when he does, he'll realize he supports it. We've really reached it. We've reached a level of total absurdity here, by the way, right? This is beyond the pale. But peeling away all of the layers of obstruction and ignorance leaves us with a simple truth. Donald Trump wants less trade with China and more conflict with them. If that's what you want, signing the TPP is the rational way to get less trade and more conflict with China. Because guess what, guys? Barack Obama also wanted less trade and more conflict with China. Hillary Clinton wanted less trade and more conflict with China. Because the deep state wants less trade and more conflict with China because they want to contain it because they fear its rising status. And Donald Trump will therefore sign the TPP. QED. An article here on foreign policy. That is exactly what Trump was saying from the perspective of a pro-TPP person. That's a poor characterization. It's about the TPP and all the things that it's saying about the TPP are what Donald Trump wants. If he doesn't bend on this, he'll prove that he's being driven entirely by ego, okay? That's really the analysis of this that I think needs to be taken away from. If Donald Trump does not realize that he supports the TPP, then he's unreachable. That his ego is everything. That he cannot accept the premise that he might be mistaken and is willing to do any and every absurd thing imaginable to avoid admitting error. His really only core message was getting tough on China. And that's a message that no doubt resonated with the establishment that put him in power. He will either understand the agreement and sign it, or he will refuse to understand the agreement and tear it up out of spite. And while I oppose the agreement, I think that such a reaction of narcissism over reason will send a message that should be taken with the utmost seriousness. It would be a broadcast to the world that he is unaffected by rational thought, that he's unreachable by logic. And thus, this is what is ahead of us. Donald Trump will sign the TPP, or he will broadcast to the world that he is insane. And I oppose it, by the way. Again, I'll say that again. But this is... he cannot possibly oppose the TPP and hold to his East Asian foreign policy. That is a staggering, stark, ridiculous contradiction. And he could only hold to that if he won't listen to anyone. And so this is a litmus test. It's a very important one. I'm not going to like the outcome. I don't like the outcome. I'm not going to like anything this guy does, okay? I'm not going to like anything about what he does. I'm not going to like the way he holds the sandwich, okay? But watch this. Because if he doesn't sign it, then we've got a crazy person running the world. We've got a nutcase. Even though, again, like I say, I oppose it. I hope you got my logic here. I hope you understand what I'm trying to say. Well, it's 1:30. I'm about to hit the hay here. Not because I need to sleep, but because I need to mix. And I want to be awake before I mix again. What did I get done after my little detour on the internet, which is now over? I got an instrumental mix of the Second Symphony, and I split it up, meaning that the record is now done except those three tracks in the middle, is 9, 10, 11. It also means inri 19 is now done except for the vocal part, which means that also inri 20 is done except for the vocal part, whatever it is. Or at least it's done in theory. I'm going to have to listen to see which mixes I want to pull out and which mix I want to put vocal part on. That means I have just a number of very small tasks to complete for tomorrow. Right now I'm just going to... let me rephrase that. The Second Symphony, the instrumental version of the Second Symphony, is tentatively complete. Tentatively. Tentatively means is that I have very little confidence in the sound path outwards at the moment, but the flip side of that is that I didn't have to do anything, right? I just ran... The first and third parts through the same filter that I put everything else through. And the second and fourth were done, and I left the fifth vanilla. So I just had to splice it, and I think I spliced it good. I think I did. And that means that, there really wasn't much to do except to paste it together and output it, or render it, so it's done. But I gotta move it over to the other room. That's what I'm gonna do for the rest of the night, or the rest of the day, is I'm going to listen to that a couple of times on the laptop, which is like the worst place to listen to it, except that I know that it's stable. So that's what I'm doing, and I'm out of here. We'll talk again later tonight, which might be tomorrow morning, depending on how long I'm awake and how much I sleep. We'll find out. I want to be up fresh because I want to mix. As we know, I don't think it's worthwhile to try to mix until at least after midnight. We'll see when.